a minute early, I'll try to share that on my page as well.
Okay, lovely.
Let's see how that works.
There we go. Now I'm trying to go live on Instagram, and it won't let me connect it until I try and go live. So if you two would just like to talk amongst yourselves.
Sure. So Sarah, how have you been?
Yeah, good. I mean, just it's weird. It's so weird because, you know, the year before lockdown, our business just stopped. So all our restaurant supply business was just, this was like the year that we were really sort of on top of the whole situation, and suddenly that evaporated. But Dale's super happy because the bees are in great order this year. They come through the winter with almost no losses. And it's been like this textbook spring here. You could literally tick off the week that each plant, each tree was flowering and stuff. So, I mean, the build-up in the hives was just exemplary. The disease levels are really low. We've got a huge amount of EFB in London, which is a disaster, but we sort of know where that's come from. There's one beekeeper who's very, yeah, just not on top of that. Second year in a row, huge EFB outbreak. So we're really, really concerned about, you know, just making sure that that's not spreading to our hives. But generally, we don't get a lot of drift to other apiaries because we're pretty well provisioned around here. So, you know, we sort of go on with our bees and looking after them and putting honey in jars again. I was saying, I haven't done that for a couple of years. Now it's like jars are the way forward, you know. So, hey.
Okay, we are live. We've got our first viewer. So thank you, whoever you are. So if you're viewing this, you can actually comment and we will be able to see your comments. So if you have any questions, you can type them in there. And at the end of the presentation, we'll have some time for questions. So I will start. So I'm Paula Carnell. I'm creating a buzz about health, and I'm involved with this project with Ilanga-Nature, where we have a mission to raise enough from honey sales to plant 1 million trees in Madagascar. So we launched a crowdfunding campaign this morning. So we will be putting the link for the crowdfunder. We'll actually go in the comments, so you'll see that. And hello, Olga. So we're here and we're going to be talking about honey for business during this session. So the early one this morning was about trees for bees and how trees feed the bees and why we would want to be planting trees in the first place and what the connection is between trees and bees. And you'll be able to see that we have recorded it and it will be posted up on various social medias. So you will be able to catch that later. So for this session, Honey for Business, I'm joined with Sarah Wyndham Lewis, who is, oh, hi, Steve. We have Steve as well. So Sarah Wyndham Lewis is from London and she runs Bermondsey Street Bees. And she's also the author of this book here, Planting for Bees. So she's an ideal person to link between honey for business and planting for bees and why trees help. And then we also have Madvee, Muthu, who's from Kenya at the moment, but has a lot of experience of the Indian Ocean islands and Madagascar, including Madagascar and Ethiopia. So lots of exciting places for honey production. And so we're going to have a bit of a chat about honey for business and the practicalities of having a honey business, the problems and the challenges that Ilanga-Nature in Madagascar could be facing and how we can help. And, you know, why it is good to have a global honey industry. You know, why do we need honey from different places in the world? So I will be showing a short film as well about the bees in Madagascar. So what I could do is I think I'll start with a little short film that we can all watch. So you've got a bit of a taste and it has the most wonderful music, which just sets the scene for beautiful Madagascar.
Up your eyes, there is nowhere left for us to hide. Get the feeling that we're lost, these hands are tied.
Wow, that was lovely.
I know. It's just such powerful music. Mm. It must make you, must connect with you, Madvee, I suppose, with your travelling around.
It does.
Right, so if you'd like to introduce yourself, so we'll start with Sarah. So if you could tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do,
mm-hmm.
And a bit of a background.
Yeah, so Bermondsey Street Bees was founded in 2007, and we are a determinedly sustainable beekeeping business, and that is a word that we take very, very seriously. So that is about running our hives, which are nearly 100 hives, so we're not huge by any means, but we are commercial bee farmers. We run them for the welfare of the bees, not for honey. The honey that we get is a joyful incidental thing alongside keeping healthy bees. Now, London currently has the densest honeybee population of anywhere in Europe by a factor of 3 times. So we're really overstuffed with bees, and we're looking at shrinking green space. So when we started beekeeping, it was before the great boom of hobby beekeeping, but people were sort of piling in, and we suddenly thought, this is serious. We really need to look to our bees' welfare. And we started doing a lot of work and talking to a lot of people who were already working in London ecology, and an understanding that actually there was so much we could contribute to the debate about better beekeeping, templates for good practice of keeping bees, so not in crowded places. You know, we're looking at a background of rising disease figures, lower yields, a lot of things that tell us that honeybees are stressed. So whilst we run a commercial honey business, the emphasis is always on doing this without leaving a big footprint. And that involves not allowing our honeybees to forage at the expense of the wild pollinators, who are the ones when people say, well, save the bees. You know, we're not really talking about honeybees in that instance. I think we're talking about the other. In this country, there's 250 species of bee, and the honeybee is one of those. Globally, you're looking at 25,000 bee species, of which only 7,000, are honeybees. So those honeybees, generalist feeders, they can strip an environment very, very effectively if they are not fed properly, and feeding comes from planting. And linking back to the whole tree issue, one of the things that we're very keen on is talking about trees to people, because they are a tree-dwelling insect. They evolved alongside trees. They are species-specific foragers. And so they can actually be foraging in the trees and leaving the other forage at more ground level at certain times of year to the wild pollinators so that they can get their colonies going. So more and more, as we go on, we find ourselves counted towards equally working with the wild pollinators and our honeybees, and hopefully finding some equilibrium in that business.
Gosh, thank you. So yeah, it's a really interesting thing, because people are always saying, oh, I want to save the bees, let me get some bees, you know. And most people, we were talking earlier, most people think that bees, all bees are the same. All bees have honey, yellow and black stripy fluffy thing. But, you know, as we all know, there's 20 odd thousand species of bees, and just such a small proportion of that are the honeybees. Mm. So we have all these native pollinators that are so key. Mm. And, you know, when people say to me, oh, I want to have some bees in my garden, I want to save the bees. And the first thing I say is, right, you'll add 50,000 more hungry mouths into the garden. Have you got enough food there at the moment for all the bees that are living there, all the bees in your lawn, in the hedges, you know?
Absolutely, you've got bees already. Plant for them, they'll come. You don't need, you know, you just don't need to have a hive. And, you know, there's this amazing statistic that every single hive requires 250 kilos of nectar and 50 kilos of pollen every year just to stay alive. That, if you think about the nothing of a breath of pollen, imagine that each hive has to gather 50 kilos of that, and the nectar, where does it come from? It doesn't come from magic. And I'm afraid for a lot of people, they don't make the connection that by getting bees, you become a stockman. You become somebody who's responsible for a colony of creatures that have an impact. They're not necessarily benign. There's a tendency for people to consider that the act of getting bees is in itself virtuous, of being a beekeeper is inherently virtuous. I think nowadays that that has changed, and we have to be more conscious of our role as beekeepers, which I think, you know, all three of us totally get. That's part of our work as honey sommeliers, isn't it? Is, you know, understanding a lot more rather than just that plonking mentality, seeing the world through a prism, other beekeepers of other places, other lands, other necessities, is really, really salutary. It really does help actually form a better picture of how we can tread in a more likely in an environment.
Yeah, absolutely. So Madvee, you have a business, Bees with Stories. So tell us a bit about your background and how you got involved with bees.
All right. Hi, everyone who's connected. So I started Bees with Stories. So the research for it started in 2017. And I initially got interested with bees and beekeeping in general, because I was working on a forest conservation project. And one of the activities that they promote in forest conservation is beekeeping. Because in an African setting, you can't just go and tell a community, like, stop cutting down trees, and because that's what they sell, the wood to make a living out of that. So you can't just go and tell them to stop doing that. You actually have to provide an alternative income generation activity, and beekeeping is one of those. So I thought, oh, that's like a really good idea. It has so much potential, and beekeeping is not just, you know, it doesn't just give you honey, but it's actually good for the environment, good for forests and biodiversity conservation. So the more I read about it, the more I got interested, and I thought, oh, this is something that has so much more potential. And I was always very curious about how, when you travel, you find, you can find honey from different places. Like you can find Manuka honey all over the world, but the minute you step out of Ethiopia, you do not get Ethiopian honey. If you get out of Madagascar, you do not get Malagasy honey outside of the country. So I thought that would be like a really, there's a really good potential here to make people be aware of the different types of honey that we have, the different and very unique flavors and taste, but at the same time help with forest conservation and provide an income to the communities managing the hive. And that's sort of how Bees with Stories started. And like 2.5 years later, I'm currently working with about 1,300 beekeepers from Tanzania, Ethiopia, and Madagascar. And we harvest and sell throughout the year six to seven different types of honey varietals, for now all certified organic. And the idea is to have a wide selection representing all the countries, all the different regions in Africa.
Wonderful, wonderful. So, yeah, so between us, you know, we've built up this picture of honey, and, you know, when you start keeping bees, you just think there's one type of honey, and then as you start working with the bees, or as you meet other beekeepers and you taste their honeys, you realize that there are so many varietals. And then you can see the connection with plants, because we have so many plants, and every plant has a different taste and has a different medicinal property. So it makes sense that the honeys that are made from those plants, you know, it's magical, isn't it? And it's endless. And this is what
a life's work ahead of us all.
It is thrilling. Well, this evening at the live honey tasting, we have Amina Harris, who's been tasting honeys for 50 years. So, you know, it is just incredible. And and it keeps changing. And I think as more people become aware of the single varieties of honey that are available, then beekeepers are adapting to that. And if you work in a more sustainable way with your bees, instead of taking all the honey off in one go and then mixing it all up together, you can take small quantities, and you know that that's a dandelion variety, or and last year, Sarah, your Tree of Heaven honey, I mean, that was
amazing. Amazing. I mean, we in London often don't have the leisure of taking off small quantities of honey because we don't have a sufficient crop. And so we tend to leave our spring honey on because also we often have a very cold spring snap. Last year was one of the first years where we ever across about 4 or 5 apiaries took a spring honey. So we had a bramble honey. We had all sorts of wonderful things. It was such a treat. It really was. But for those, you know, friends of ours who beekeep the countryside, they often have got a really full spring crop. And I'm always sort of first in the queue. Like I want to taste that because, you know, a British dandelion honey is a very different thing from an Italian dandelion honey. I mean, again, even within these single varietals, they are so, so different. And, you know, all of those things become like a real obsessive thrill. Like, I want to taste this honey. I want to taste it.
I know. And I'm sure we've all got vast collections of honey.
Yes,
so shall we talk a little bit about the Ilanga honey? So what do you think are the challenges that a company in Madagascar are going to be facing? So Madvee, perhaps you could talk to us about, you know, about the country. I mean, I will show a map for those who are watching who are not entirely sure of where we're talking about. So we have a map of the world, and Madagascar is down there in red. Now, when I was a child, I remember reading that Madagascar was full of the richest rainforests and the most unexplored areas on the planet. And now it's been deforested and there's only 25% left of the woodland, I believe. So, Madvee, can you enlighten us a bit about the challenges there?
So, like, Madagascar is one of the biodiversity hotspots in the world, one of the very few remaining. And it's one of those places where every year they still have new discoveries. There are thousands of plants and flowers that have yet to be identified. So it is, in its own right, like, an amazing place in terms of biodiversity. And but sadly, what has been happening like over the past years is like massive deforestation in the area where I work, Manakara, and I believe Ilanga is operates in that region as well. The like trees are falling, like are being cut at an alarming rate, and again, it's really hard to, you know, manage it because people live under like the absolute poverty rate there. So they are struggling. They cut down trees to make a living. So it's not just about tackling deforestation. You actually tackle like mainly social issues when you are providing them with a source of income. So beekeeping is one of them, and making sure that the beekeepers see the value of the bees to them, but also like, because it's not just we can't just talk in like an idealistic like way and talk about biodiversity. It has to make an impact on their life, and it's only like through like managing the hives, harvesting the honey, selling the honey, so that they can see the direct impact on their life, that we can like begin to make a difference.
Yeah, in this morning's talk, I had an interview with Laura who manages Ilanga-Nature honey in Madagascar. And she was saying about how the beekeepers have become the guardians of the forests. And because they now have a market for their honey, and because their honey is collected straight from the beekeepers, there's no chance for that adulteration. You know, it's not a case of them taking honey and shipping it somewhere where it gets mixed up. You know, Ilanga-Nature have their truck, it comes, it picks up the honey, and they get paid for it, and they know that they need the trees. And as the deforestation continues, their bees are going hungry, so they're desperate for more trees. So when they have the trees planted, and this is what's so exciting, is that they're supporting the watering of them and maintaining of those trees, rather than quite often, you know, in the West we can think, oh, I've just sent a check and there's 100 trees being planted, but you don't know if they're being looked after and maintained. In 6 months' time, those trees, or even a week's time, they could be dead. So it's really good to know that you have this cooperation between the beekeepers just to maintain those forests. And by having that income, they're supporting their community, so they can then inspire their neighbours to stop cutting down trees for charcoal and, you know, and looking after the trees. And if they look after the trees as well, they could have some beehives. And then they're all sort of, it's uplifting the whole community, and they can send their children to school. And then with education, that changes. So it's amazing, isn't it, the impact that just something as simple as honey can make, but also that connection, you know, that planting a tree can feed the bees, selling the honey can give the family money, they can send their kids to school, it improves the whole community. And then with the trees planted in that part of the world, it affects our climate system, no matter how far away we are. So we are all connected. So, you know, when, again, we were speaking with Michelle this morning, and people talk about buying local, and local honey is best for us all. You know, if you suffer from hay fever, you want to have the honey that's from within your area, because that's got portions of the pollen that's probably triggering your allergy. But we are a global community, and although if you go to your local farm shop and you have your local honey, Michelle was saying about, he was trying to sell his farm shop some of the Ilanga honey in Belgium, and they're saying, oh no, we only have local things. And he said, but what about the coffee you've got? Oh, well, we have to have. And, you know, and then people started coming in saying, well, we want bananas and we want pineapples. And then we are a global community. We've been trading around the world forever. But now we really have to be conscious about who we're trading with and the impact of the money we spend. Where is that going? And who is it helping or not helping? You know, if we're buying cheap honey, is it even honey? And what behaviors or practices is that actually supporting? So, you know, that's the thing. And, you know, how much information can you put on a honey jar that anyone can understand? So it's us tasting it and go, just taste that freedom, taste that countryside.
I also, I see my role very much as a storyteller, because I don't think I have the greatest palate on earth. I mean, you know, we sort of in the same class, and I'm like, yeah, I get some of it I don't. I'm not red hot on spotting, you know, whatever it may be. But that doesn't matter to me, because what I am red hot on is the stories behind it. And those are what they matter to me so much. I see the honey. It's very much a thing, terroir, the way that you can tell the story of the people who produce that honey is in the pleasure of the mouth. People are very receptive to that, and they will understand so much more. It connects them to nature in a way that people have lost hugely. You know, we were saying earlier, half people, they have no idea what sort of bee produces honey, what honey even is, you know, why they make it. And, you know, that if you ask people, why do honeybees produce honey? They would look at you completely blankly. You say, well, because they're making it to store, to see them through tough times. That's what makes a honeybee a honeybee. They're going through tough times, whether that be winter or the rainy season, as a colony. They've got to eat something. And they go, oh, okay, it suddenly dawns on them. You know, they can connect through. And equally, you know, we're talking about the forage sources, that grounds people in that place and understanding that things are a product of that place. So it's not some horrible blended ersatz honey product. It's something that is an actual expression. It's like a culinary adventure of in your palate and understanding and connecting with those people. I'm always so keen to tell the story of the beekeepers themselves, because so many beekeepers, even in this country, are more or less subsistence farmers. None of us, let's face it, are ever going to get rich being beekeepers or selling honey. It's not a first world, third world divide. It's an actual truth, you know, that there isn't a lot of money. So we all do it out of passion, you know, at the sort of levels that we're talking about, unless you've got, you know, 4,000 hives, in which case you can, you know, could probably support a family on that. But for most of us, it's not about that. It's about using it as a demonstration of the things that we really care about and connecting the environment with this divine substance that we, you know, we have the pleasure of introducing people to, and the stories that accompany it. So I'm super happy to classify myself as a storyteller as much as anything else.
Yeah, and I feel I'm a storyteller and a connector. You know, you world, and you're thinking, right, you two should meet each other because you can help.
Yes, yes. And isn't it lovely? I mean, that's one of the joys of beekeeping. I mean, there's a lot of petty jealousy and spite, let's face it, that goes on in that community. Sometimes people are very much looking over their shoulders, but generally, as a community, I would say that we're an incredibly generous, open and sharing community. We want to share resources. We love connecting people who have things in common. And you know, there's nothing like a beekeeperly chat or a chat about honey, is there? It's absolutely totally engaging because everybody has their own tuppence halfpenny worth to bring to it. You know, they have that thing of, oh, you've got four beekeepers in a room, you've got six opinions.
Oh, yeah. And even that changes. Some people say it's 11 opinions or one beekeeper has three, you know.
It's just, but it's true, it is true. You know, there are no certainties, there are no absolutes. There's only what we know and understand. And that's one of the reasons why traveling is so crucial, to meet other beekeepers, to see the world through their eyes. It's all very well us sitting here and go, this is this and that is that. As Madvee was saying, these things, you can't tell people that they mustn't cut down trees and make a living, you know, producing charcoal. They've got to feed their kids. So you've got to be able to put them in a situation where they can make a sustainable living from another product. But then that's got to go end to end, which goes to this bees in business thing. You know, they can't make this product in isolation. It then depends on other people to come in and say, I can take this product and I can sell it in a place which actually feeds money back into the grassroots. So that's what I call the economy, and it's really super important. It's miles away from all of that packing and processing and adding sugar and all of that, which is a different economy and a very corrupt one. What we're all trying to do is to actually go as directly as possible from the producer, whether that's our own hives or, you know, people that we know and have connected with, through to the point of sale, to the point where the consumer can actually say, I'm interested in this product, it's going to offer me an experience that I'm not going to get from, you know, another product. And that's the opportunity for the retailer. You know, in this modern world, everyone's looking for stories and social content and marketing content. What could be more amazing than a honey that comes from Madagascar, has this incredible, I mean, that mobile truck, I was literally going, oh my God, that is so brilliant. That is so brilliant. They don't have to travel with that honey. As you say, there's no possibility that anyone could say that's been tampered with or corrupted or anything. There it is. The honey's going in. They have a hand in the processing. Off it goes in its vats. That is just inspiring. That's a wonderful thing to see that. And I had no idea that that's what happened there. And, you know, it's not universal, but somebody's invested a lot of money in those facilities. And that's fantastic, because it means at this end you've got a honey that can be more readily certified, can be sold with a huge amount of confidence, because there's a lot of honey knocking about bottom shelf of health food shops and you think, really, what is that honey? You know, where's it from? Is somebody pulling the wool over trying to make it look like an artisan honey when in fact it's a product of a factory somewhere? There's so much obfuscation, deliberate obfuscation, that clarity of from producer to point of sale is, I think, one of the things that we all need to be thinking about and working with, so that you have this authenticity from end to end of it. And then retailers have a real story to tell in their marketing, either at point of sale or in their social media or whatever. It all helps to build up the sort of multi-layered story, doesn't it?
It does. So Madvee, could you tell us the story of some of the trees? So we've got Mokorana, Jujube, Niuli. These are trees that we don't have.
Jujube, I believe you can find other places, but Mokorana, Niuli are endemic to Madagascar. Mokorana honey, I know that. So those are folk tales that I hear from my beekeepers, but that's what they do. So Mokorana is used to pacify babies. Apparently it has a very calming effect on them. I'm not sure what creates it. We have a very little knowledge of the makeup of the honey itself, because we have not yet done any research. That's something that we need to focus on, because the honey that you get in Madagascar is so unique, because the flowers are like only from there, that nobody else has else in the world you know, has studied them. So there's a real need to go to Madagascar and study the biodiversity, the flowers, and the honey that comes out of it.
just to pop in here, macarana fruit is being used in ovarian cancer research.
Yes.
So, yeah, that's really interesting line of research going on there, isn't it? So maybe that's a way forward for it, that people will actually, you know, look at that tree and say, we cannot afford to use this tree from the landscape. Its active constituents are so important. Mm-hmm. Sorry to interrupt. It's just I was overexcited.
Miauli is one of the, like for the COVID vaccine, Miauli, like the Malagasy government came up with this drink. It's a cocktail, like a mix of local plants. And I believe Miauli honey is being used as part of that.
But again, from Ilanga, they approached Ilanga to have the honey. So
brilliant, yeah.
So like again, we can't recommend because there's no like research that has been done on it. But as of like a couple of weeks ago, I believe that the government had approached South Africa to do some more testing because they don't have the laboratory facilities. That's one of the problems we have in Africa. Like none of the facilities required to test, do research on our honey is available. So everything that we do needs to be sent to Germany or to Belgium or to Australia. And
our honey goes to Germany as well from here. Yeah. Our honey's tested in Germany. They are the dudes as far as testing goes.
Yeah, and it's expensive. So it adds, it's a huge cost to us. But I really like if we wanted to gain the name and the reputation that it has, it is required. The investment is required.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. No, it is. So, so why do you think, or how do you think shops could benefit from having Malagasy honey in their shops? You know, if you've got I love Fortnum & Mason's and their display of honey. I mean, that's my dream store for honeys. But, you know, how can we encourage people to be wanting and interested in these honeys? Do you think it is the stories, you know, even though we have this craving for scientific proof, do you think the stories of macarana honey calming babies is enough for people to think, oh, I want to try that? You know, is it worth?
Well, you know, in this country, there's the advisory that shouldn't be given to honey. Honey shouldn't be given to babies. That's one of the things. 12 months, rather. I have noises off from a beekeeper in my ear here. It's an advisory that we might want to put it on our labels, and it's a legal requirement in other places. Yeah. So there are some things that we might say in passing to somebody, but we can't put in writing. We can't make as a firm recommendation. I think it comes back to the slightly folkloric qualities that a lot of honey has. And I think if you're wrapping the whole story up in the place, the people, and I write a column for Beecraft every month, and in that I'm looking at the traditional qualities of honey. I'm not saying this is understood to be absolute dead cert for whatever. What I'm saying is that traditionally in the community from which this honey comes, these are the uses to which it's been put for thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of years sometimes. And I think that's fair enough. I think that, you know, as long as you're not saying it's going to cure everything, you can say it has had these qualities attributed to it. I think people do have, quite often it's really fascinating when I'm teaching and I have a group of 10 or 12 people. Quite often I've got a very mixed bunch. I've got some Eastern Europeans. I've got, you know, all sorts of people coming from different cultures. The stories they tell me about honey and medicine are so wonderful. Which honey is used for what? What granny is always this thing about granny. It's like we skipped a generation. That division between food and medicine is fairly modern. You know, where we go to the chemist for medicine and we go, you know, to wherever the market for food. Actually, they are intertwined. They're the same thing. And we sort of lost that direction, but people's grannies haven't. And there's always stories about before school, granny would give me some of this honey, whether it be Leatherwood in Tasmania or wherever it may be. It's almost universal. I mean, I'm almost thinking of writing a book called What Granny Gave Me, because I just keep hearing this. So I think that those things are perfectly suited to point of sale deliciousnesses of one sort or another, just saying it comes from this community where it is traditionally used for this, and here are its flavor profiles as well. I'm astonished by how many people try and sell honey without telling you what it tastes like, because that's a big ask for the customer, isn't it? You know what they're buying each other. That's not good enough. That's what we're trying to get away from, is that uni honey or that honey colored honey. You know, look at these Malagasy honeys have just got, you know, huge variety of colors and textures and stuff. So I'm always keen to give people the chance to taste without taste. Yeah, look at that. It's just lovely. So we go, you know, from white to black in effect, whereas, you know, all honey in supermarkets is sold in this one color that they construct. So again, the story of the colors of the honey, because people often say, why have you got all these different colored honey? So it's almost like this suspect you of sort of coloring it or something. That's what nature does. Nature has this wonderful, you know, diversity of stuff. You know, if something is always the same, that is not natural. Everything in nature is programmed for chaos and differentiation. That's the profound health of the honey is in that. You know, the use of dark honey because it's full of antioxidants. You know, all of those stories. So sorry to witter on, but I do think it's legitimate for us to attribute those qualities which are traditionally identified with things. And indeed, if there's modern research, to add that into the mix and say this is also being used for X or Y. So buckwheat honey is a constituent of quite a lot of blood pressure medicine. So that's one of the reasons that buckwheat is grown as a cash crop, is to provide the raw materials for blood pressure medicine. And big pharma, this is not, you know, little folk remedies. So there are actually quite a lot of honeys in production which already have a very strong medical connection. And I think that just adds veracity to what we're saying about its potency, really.
Yeah, yeah. So what do you think, Madvee? You agree with that?
I think, like, just as Sarah said, there is a lot of granny tales. Most of us, like, we know there's some truth in that. We just don't prove it, right? Because we've experienced it ourselves. But I think there's also a component, like the social aspect component appeals to people a lot. Last year when we did our launch in the UK, I attended a trade show, and because Europeans are not used to African honey, they're not used to the taste, they're not used to the color, they're not used to the flavor. So we thought, okay, one good way to introduce it and see how people react to it would be attend a trade show, have people taste it firsthand. We get like firsthand feedback. And we did that, and people loved it. They thought it was, you know, it was different, but they were curious about it. And especially like people who love honey, love trying like different types of honey.
Oh, yeah.
They love that part. But what grabbed them was hearing the story around it, knowing that it wasn't just the honey, it wasn't just like unique flowers, it was also helping people back home. And I think that is like, that's key, because in the UK, I mean, and that would depend on every country, but in the UK, people still want to, like, you know, like do good, like when they're buying stuff. You do have like a huge portion of the population that is trying to buy and be more conscious and when they're buying. So there's definitely a crowd that it would appeal to. And that's not the crowd that would go to a large supermarket and buy the shelf honey. That's because that's not even the same price range. You can't make honey.
There's no equation between them.
So like when we wanted to enter the UK market, we decided, you know what? Like I went to all the big stores and we had that discussion. I'm like, I'm not sure this is the route I want to take, because I don't want to to go and compete against the factory manufactured honey.
I agree with you so much.
Yeah. And I'm like, the honey that I bring might not appeal to everybody, but it is special. It is good quality. It is organic. And it is made in such a pristine environment that it's really important that we don't lose that just by trying to sell.
So yeah, race to the bottom is never going to benefit a premium product. You have to have, I mean, we know, we went through this in the early days. Do we have the nerve to hold our price points? It was a really difficult decision, you know, not to just sell at a loss because people were saying, well, you know, it's too expensive. But one of the reasons that we pulled out of grocery, pulled out of all sorts of places like Planet Organic, was because our honey we knew to be ethically and sustainably produced is sitting alongside honey that equally we know not to be.
Yeah,
but it wasn't differentiated. So for us, that was one of the reasons why we pulled out of that, because it's a really tough market. There's a lot of noise in it. So it is always that thing of just trying to find a way to set yourself above and aside from. And I think that comes from authenticity. It comes back to authenticity all the time, is can you show people, you know, as you were saying, how much it matters when they buy that honey, how the money that they're spending actually directly benefits people. So, I mean, there's a huge opportunity in this country, because only 14% of the honey that's sold in this country is actually made here. So that's a very big sector that's available to sell good honey, you know, from a further afield. Now, obviously, the greater chunk of that is going to be taken up by imported, blended, processed honeys, that bleh, honey. But there's still that niche for people who are, you know, self-selected honey connoisseurs and are fascinated by different varietals. The corollary of what we're talking about here, about storytelling and stuff, and about tastings, the next question that people always ask me is, what do you do with it? So that's really important, is to then provide people with, we used to do like a little recipe sheet that we gave out with people saying, here's how to make a honey dressing, here's how to use honey in all these different ways. And people, you know, it really wasn't a big production, it was just a little thing, but people bore it off. They were so excited by just being given this at point of sale. It was an A4 sheet that was just folded into eight with recipes from some of the chefs we work with, and some of them were quite famous chefs, other people were bartenders. We just brought it all together. So, I mean, they were just utterly thrilled with this tiny, tiny little thing. But what it did was it meant that you're adding their potential to use that jar quicker by actually giving them some guidelines. Yeah. And I think that's the final part in the mosaic of selling honey, exotic honeys, or, you know, honeys with real stories into, you know, through the retail situation in this country, is to give people the armory to buy it, feel that they've made a great choice, understand a story that they'll tell their friends about it as well. Hopefully that's really key. And then get them to use the stuff, not put it in their kitchen cupboards, because there's an awful lot of honey sitting in kitchen cupboards that people have bought. And then, you know, frankly, some honeys are not nice on toast. they're all right, you know, but Manuka, I would say Manuka is not nice on toast. I really wouldn't. It's not pleasant. And there's a few other varietals which are pretty challenging, but if you know how to pair them with a good cheese or something like that, then it's just a phenomenal experience. And again, I think that's part of our job as honey sommeliers, is to actually be on top of that and saying to people, it's not just about putting it in your porridge, or if you're going to put it in a herb tea, don't choose something which is going to be so aromatic that it's going to destroy the quality of the tea or the coffee or the whatever, because that can be really unpleasant. You know, honey has different uses, different honey, so all the more reason to acquire a little library, because one of them will go in your herb tea, another one will be the one that you're drizzling on top of a freshly baked cake or whatever. So I think that is the last part of the equation, is to get people to use it, not just buy it out of interest.
What I love is the lychee honey that I like to do is so good in a fruit salad, and they recommend it, and I don't normally add anything to a fruit salad, but I thought, oh, well, I'll just give it a go, and it was amazing because it brought all the fruits
alive,
and you could still taste the lychee. It was magic. But I also love these gift boxes, and again, talking to Laura, they actually use the local wood, and they're handcrafted boxes in Madagascar, so everything is done there. But I think these are perfect as corporate gifts. You know, it's so gorgeous, you know, to have this beautiful wooden box with five honeys in, and, you know, you can't really beat a gift like that, you know, especially, I wish.
No, we always say the gift of honey is never a bad gift.
No, that's right. So with the Crowdfunder, we've put together packages so either retailers can have a selection of honeys, or they can have a selection of gift boxes, or even if somebody has a business and they're normally buying bottles of wine or chocolate or events, they can then have packages of honey.
Because it's really interesting you say that, because we tend to price our honey off wine. We maintain a honey list, just like a wine list, with tasting notes, with reflections on the year, where what the forage is, all of that sort of stuff. And the language is very much that of a wine list, and we do tend to price it against, and particularly our tasting boxes, are the cost of a bottle of wine that you might take to a friend for dinner, or if you're staying the weekend with somebody. So it's at that sort of optionality level. It's something, you know, it looks lovely, as that box does. Half of it is about presentation in that market of gifts and corporate gifts. And also, I mean, who's not going to be thrilled? It's the most wonderful thing to open up a box and just have this panoply of stuff there. It's just such a joy, more than a bottle of wine in many ways, because I think it's more accessible. You know, well, children shouldn't be drinking wine either. You know, the whole family is going to participate in this gift, or, you know, whatever it may be, and that's quite a consideration. So I think that is definitely the way forward: presentation at point of sale, information at point of sale, you know, every bit of the process of what they're going to do with this honey and their understanding of it, sort of gently catered for and given credence. And then what you're doing is you're giving them confidence in spending money, quite a lot of money, compared to, you know, what they might see on shelf in somewhere. And I'm not just talking about supermarkets here, because that's, you're talking about price points. Lidl had honey for £1 two Christmases ago, a squeezy bottle of honey for £1. That is insane. But there's quite a lot of honey at that, like, £4, £5 mark. And I know from talking to chefs and talking to people, you know, who come when we're doing the occasional sort of like pop-up or whatever, people believe that to be real honey. They say, oh no, I know not to buy the really cheap honey, so I don't, you know, I'm always about £5 or £6. I said, well, mostly in terms of the EU's analysis of beekeeping and the costs of beekeeping, you can't even get it in a jar for that. The beekeeper cannot even put the honey in a jar for that price. So if you're paying $4.99 or $5.99, I'm afraid, no matter what you think, you're still not really breaking free from that process market. And that thing of holding our prices at the high end and comparing ourselves to other luxury products is super, super, super important for us if we're ever going to make a market in good honey.
Absolutely. And the thing go on, Madvee.
No, I feel like there's a lot of information, awareness raising that needs to be done, a lot of education of the customer, because when I first started out, I had a focus group and I had a bunch of, I would say, like 10 to 12 people, and I bought every varietal you can find in a Mauritian supermarket, and I had people blind taste it, and the honey that was the most sugary, the worst of the worst, was what was treated as the real honey. I'm like, guys, people are so used to the bad quality bottom of the lot, like, type of honey, like, and they have, like, they're accustomed to that taste, that when they're given real honey, the good quality stuff, they don't know.
What I do is I sneak up on them. So I'll give them two or three really good honeys. I'll teach them how to taste it. I'll teach them how to explore it with retronasal tasting and all sorts of wonderful gimmickry that they'll take away and remember. And then I give them a supermarket honey. And they all go, this is disgusting. The sugars are really pokey and horrible. I mean, I always think with our, you know, honey, sort of it clags my teeth. It doesn't want to go on my palate. Real honey melts away on your palate so beautifully and effectively. So that one thing about that mouthfeel difference, and they're all, and also the weird thing is the smell of that supermarket, of that cheap honey. It smells of medicine, sort of like an antiseptic sort of smell, but with this perfumed, almost cosmetic sort of appropriation of what honey might be like over the top of it. So again, when I've had their noses in a few jars of real honey and said, have you noticed that this one thing it doesn't smell of is honey? as Disney, you know, in the Disney fantasy honey or the Body Shop type equivalent of honey, none of that is there. Other things are there to explore. But then when you, you know, squeeze one of those things, it does smell of honey, because it's, again, it's a construct. It's what they think people think that honey's about. So I'm not at all surprised that you were getting that reaction. I think yeah. Smuggle it later down the line is the way forward.
Yeah. No, but yeah. that was actually like an exercise that I did early on just to understand where I was starting in terms of, you know, my customer base and yeah. where I wanted to go. But like one thing like that's really problematic in the UK and also in Europe, like the labeling that's required. Oh. So like you can take a jar of honey and it says blend of EU, non-EU countries. Yeah. That's literally the entire world. So yes. you don't know where the honey.
But what you can say, which is what I say to people all the time, whenever there is, never buy honey that has the B word on it, because there's no legitimate reason on earth to blend honey. Absolutely yeah. none. So if it says B blend on it, you put it straight down. Even yeah. if you know nothing else about labeling, doesn't matter what it says, put it down and find something that isn't a blend, and you're starting from a better point. And that sort of like, this is my way of sneaking up on you know, the fact that there is this extraordinary labeling. There's a lot of pressure being put from the top down to resist better labeling as we leave the EU. The EU is on the brink of issuing much better labelling, I believe, and where it says non-EU honeys or EU honeys, they're actually, in theory, possibly going to have to list those honeys. That's work that's being done at the moment by a big European farming group, which, if you like, I can share that report with you guys because it's super interesting and important. I don't think that that's going to happen in this country because I think there is literally no will within DEFRA to do that. I don't think they've got the bandwidth to start addressing the matter of what raw means, so they're just much rather just sort of blanket out. So that one thing of, if it says blend on it, put it back, is the thing that we can equip people with to make them more discerning buyers of better honey.
Yeah, I'm going to open it up now that those watching, if you have any questions, if you type them in the comments, and if you'd like to ask anything, then we can answer it. And Randy has posted the Crowdfunder link. So if you are interested in trying some Ilanga honey, you can not only get the honey at good prices, but not cheap prices. So what Ilanga are doing is, because of the shipping is very expensive, so quite often one jar of honey can cost just as much to ship. So what they're doing for this crowdfunding is working out a way that people can taste the honey, experiment with different varieties, but also there's enough profit in there to be planting the trees. So we have packages of two honeys, and we've already selected the options of which flavors, so the ones that we think would be quite nice to taste together. So I've got a question here from lovely, lovely Esther. If any of you met Esther, you would love her. So using honey as a health property, is it best to choose a local honey producer? What are the benefits from global source health or good? So I think she's saying, you know, what we were talking about earlier about, if you have your local honey, it's good for hay fever. But if you're really looking for a healthy honey, what are the benefits of buying from somewhere else?
Can I jump in, Madvee? I have a very strong opinion on this. So local honey in this country, we are the, you know, the polyfloral world. It's too small a country to produce any dependable monoflorals. People do small batches, but I mean, generally what you're looking at in a local honey is going to be a polyfloral. So that's great if you're talking about hay fever, because it has those things in which are going to, you know, tip your histamine reactions, and you're rehearsing your encounter with them by taking the honey, and it can really help. I mean, so many people tell us that it helps them. When you're looking at the monoflorals, the great world monoflorals, you have very distinct medicinal properties that are attributed to them. So there are things like Manuka, which is brilliant for skin lesions, absolutely fantastic and unbeatable. You have chestnut, they tend to be dark, they tend to be full of antioxidants, particularly things like, you know, what's called the forest honeys, the aphid honey. Those are sort of double value in terms of medicinal properties. So those are the ones that we were talking about that tend to have very clear properties attributed to them. They tend to be monoflorals, and we're not great on those in this country. So I think there's a role for both. If you want a kitchen pharmacy, I think the answer is to have, you know, a fair selection of things which you use selectively for different reasons. I just I'm not a fan of Manuka honey in any way. It's one of the most widely forged honeys on earth. But if you actually have got some proper Manuka honey, I just healed my dog's paw with it. I mean, after weeks of trouble with the place she was licking, in the end, I healed it with Manuka, and it was end of story. You know, I thought, why didn't I think of that earlier? So I think it's a horses for courses answer, really.
Yeah. And I think as well with the trees, and, you know, this is one of the advantages of Madagascar, because a lot of the honeys are from trees, you have the redness properties of trees, which are really rich, and, you know, so it is good. So Madvee, what would you like to comment?
No, I agree with what Sarah says. I think it depends on what exactly you're trying to treat. If it's an allergic reaction to something that comes from your environment, that it makes perfect sense to have local honey. But there is research being done on the healing properties of different types of monofloral honey. Mm. I know, like, thyme honey is used in bandages all the time. You actually can buy those. They have been commercialized in some places. So, again, it all depends what you're trying to do. But if it's just for, you know, to build up your immune system, I would say, like, yeah, pick your local honey.
Yeah, I agree.
And then Alex, who's a lovely, lovely bee lady, she's an artist and paints paintings which have the, I suppose, the messages from the flowers. So the communication, the ultraviolet light of the flowers.
Oh, wow.
Really great work. So Alex, thank you for joining us. And she asks, why is comb honey not sold more widely? It's magical. Is it just too difficult to package?
Do you know, there is a problem implicit in comb honey. It depends on where it's made, because you know, people are always saying, you know, why isn't, for instance, a London honey, when you test it, why is it not full of pollutants? And the answer is because the bees are fantastically successful chemical factories. So they're excreting the majority of things that they encounter. They've survived, you know, 88 million years, they've survived ash clouds. They can do this. They have an enormous power to actually excrete stuff which would be harmful to them. They don't store it in honey. But as people store things that are, you know, the body can't cope with in body fat. So wax is something that bees may well store stuff in. So, for instance, we don't sell wax, you know, honeycomb from urban areas. We if we're selling whole comb, we make it in wilderness areas, because we feel that that's a much, much better proposition. So there are awful figures when you test the wax that's used for foundation and stuff, which people do periodically. A lot of it has got, you know, it's not fatal, there's nothing, you know, fundamentally wrong. It's just you probably hate it. So it is one of those things of the modern world production versus, you know, where you're talking about, Madvee, with a clean and a clear sort of environment where there aren't a lot of chemicals there or heavy metal pollution or any of those things. It doesn't keep me awake at night, but it's a thing that I recognize as a factor. I am very selective about the comb that I eat. It's so delicious. And as my husband always says, it's the one thing the Chinese haven't found a way to fraudulently produce. You can be sure that what you've got is a pure honey, but on the other hand, you want to be sure that it's produced in an area where the air is clean. You haven't got a whole load of agrochemicals. And I think it's the agrochemicals that are way more polluting than, in fact, anything they might encounter in an urban environment. I find those agrochemicals and the buildup of them in the soil and all of those things just something that's so frightening. It's ghastly.
Well, it is. And I did read a report somewhere that they were finding traces of chemicals that were banned 10 years previously.
Yes.
In wax comb. So either people are still using illegal chemicals, or it just shows they're still in the soil and they're coming through the plants. So it's a concern. Yeah. But it is interesting. We had a request, one of my clients, where we bottle the honey for them for their shop and hotel guests, and we had a request for a frame of honey, and it was quite difficult to find the right packaging, and I suppose commercially as well, you have to think, if you were to spin that honey, you've got a number of bottles from it, whereas if you sell home, you've only got one item, and not
it's a very specialist premium item. And come Christmas, it's a thing that sells really well. People seem to, you know, somehow it's acquired a sort of a celebratory thing to it. Oh, we'll have a honeycomb. We sell a huge amount of comb into the commercial market, into chefs, because they're using it to a little bit to decorate pudding or whatever it may be. So that
breakfast table in a hotel. It's
breakfast table in a hotel, exactly. So that's where we make comb in specific places, and we make it for specific people, and it goes pretty much straight to them. Our experience of selling it into the customer market is problematic, because, as you say, packaging is difficult. The damage to it, the inevitable ooze of a comb as well, you know. There are problems. And some people like cut comb in a jar of honey, but obviously if it's one that's naturally going to set, you end up with just the most god awful mess. It looks horrible. Comb in set honey.
Comb, you know, you just see the honey begin.
It's not nice. You've got to have an always liquid, something like acacia, that's going to frame that honey beautifully in a sort of golden glow, and then that's a great product.
So Madvee, do they have comb honey? Do you see a lot of that in Africa, or
no, because Madagascar, the beekeepers that we work with, they use the Langstroth, so that's the only place where they do use it. But all the others, we use either log hives, or what we call transitional hives, which are like either like the log hive, as the name mentioned, it's in a log. So when we harvest, we don't have nicely shaped combs or anything like that. Yeah. They are crushed so that the honey comes out. But we don't have nicely well done like honeycombs package, and it would be a mess. And again, because it's an animal product, getting that through custom would be a mess. I don't even want to think about it, because I just know the paperwork that would require, the amount of testing and the amount of money that would be injected just to get cleared. Yeah. Just doesn't make sense to us. In Mauritius, I'm thinking of doing it, but really just like, you know, maybe a couple of hotel would require, who would request, but not on a massive scale. And also, like, I don't think it's good. It goes with the sustainable beekeeping idea, just because you don't want the bees to constantly be building new combs.
No, you don't. Absolutely. You've got to use, I mean, we manage this very carefully how we do it. Yeah. So we'll use the income from something like rape honey. We don't want rape honey. We can use their energy to build some really nice comb, and then they have a chance to fill it. So yeah, we're very strategic so as not to stress the bees. And that is a really good point. And if you're taking comb away on a unit of, you know, £8 of honey to make £1 of wax, you know, it also influences, you know, your economics in terms of the bees and their energy. And that's something we're really all trying not to do, I think, is to stress our bees any more than they are already stressed.
I have a lovely necklace that I got at Apimondia, and this is the life work of one bee.
A twelfth of a teaspoon of honey.
And I think, and that shocks so many people that is what a bee produces. And so, you know, if you don't want to waste it. It's such a precious commodity. No. And the bees need it to make their wax. As you were saying, Sarah, they need £8 to make £1 of wax. They need £8 of honey. And so if we're taking all that honey, the bees just can't survive, you know. So I'm going to bring it to a close. I've got, So Esther's saying about some honey products, certification of organic provenance to be included. Well, this is one of the problems with honey, is because bees fly 3 to 5 mile radius, it's very difficult to have a pure organic honey. And you know, you do need to be quite suspicious of some countries that claim to be organic.
Definitely, because €500 in the right place will buy you an organic certification. I know this for a fact. It's so shocking. But but you've got a clean environment, haven't you, Madvee? And so you can be sure that you're not
So in Mauritius, it's impossible to get organic certification because it's such a small land, like land mass, that there's always a small holder farmer somewhere who's using some chemicals. And we are big on using chemicals there, unfortunately. But in Ethiopia, Madagascar, and Tanzania, we work in fairly pristine environment, especially like in Ethiopia and Tanzania, we are in a, like a forest. So it's completely pristine. We do testing every year. We are certified organic. But even that, the certification is, it takes work. It's very costly because it is certified by an international body, which we have to bring over there to get them to certify. But, you know, like once you do it, then it becomes easier. In Madagascar, it depends where you are producing. Unfortunately, there are areas where they do a lot of vegetable like so, and they use more pesticide in those areas, and there's always a drift, so you have to be careful about that. So it's easier to get pristine environment, but you still have to be careful. Like you have to like find areas that are really like remote.
Mm. But it is nice because you've got it in your power then to have a super premium product, which you know, it's lovely. You know, if you've got something the way you can trust the certification, and you know it to be from a sort of virgin area, that's really exciting in itself, isn't it?
So I'm going to bring this to a close. Oh, sorry. So, if you were going to choose one of the Ilanga honeys for someone who's never tried an African honey or Madagascan honey, which one would you recommend?
Oh, I mean, look at my tasting notes here. I think the Macarana was the one that I loved most. I thought it was really interesting, that sort of resinous, fruity gorgeousness. And it also has a particularly nice mouthfeel. So I think that's my honey of choice.
Okay. What about you, Madvee?
That's mine too.
You
should try baking with it. Like replace, like if you're baking cookies, like replace the sugar with the honey. Amazing. And because it's the honey, it adds a little like chewiness in cookies that you don't get like sugar.
Okay, well, that's our winner. And Paula, what's yours?
Well, if you'd asked me yesterday, I would have said Macarana, but I went through and tasted them all again, and I tried the jujube again and I was blown away by it. I just thought, wow, I love this. So it was sort of citrusy, it was fresh, but then the Nyuli as well, which is quite a distinctive flavor.
Yeah, it's almost
savory, isn't it? But the more you taste it, the more you think, oh, actually, this is quite addictive. But what I do, and I do a honey and health box for my subscribers each month. And so they'll have different honeys from different parts of the world. And this month we're putting in a bag of organic popcorn, because what I'm finding I love to do in the evening is I make my own popcorn and then I drizzle a honey on it. Because then you're not heating the honey.
No.
You're having a really sweet popcorn. And it's just wonderful. And you can just pick away. So I just taste all the different popcorns. And then you can have the more savory honeys with the popcorn. So it's, you know, almost like salted caramel when you're.
That's a nice idea. It's a real get sticky idea as well, isn't it?
You know, you need to have a sort of finger bowl as well. So you don't have to move that one.
I spend my life fighting stickiness and it doesn't ever work.
No. So thank you so much, ladies.
I've really loved this.
And you know, I'm sure all of us have learned something, and I'm sure our audience have learned lots. So we have recorded this, so we will share it. But I'm going to end with a little film, which is from Ilanga-Nature, and it's about the honey and the beekeepers and the forest. I showed it earlier on, but it is really lovely. And Randy has put in the comments the Crowdfunder. So any of you who want to try the Ilanga-Nature honey, the Crowdfunder goes on until the end of June or 19th of June. We're going to be giving away a box set of honey to somebody who shares and promotes this this whole series of talks. Whoever does it the most, we have a technical way of finding out who that was. So they'll be receiving a beautiful handcrafted box with five honeys in. But whatever you buy on the Crowdfunder, it's helping to plant trees. And as you've learned from here, not only do we need trees for our planet, for our air, for our health, the trees are the lungs of the earth and we're all choking. So let's refresh the earth, feed the bees in Madagascar, and make a difference. You know, if you're sat at home and you're wanting some honey, then just buy it from somewhere you know. So I'm just going to play this film and I'll say farewell. So thank you very much, everybody.
Bye. So lovely to see you both.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Zay ety izany a gajerena ny eo amin'ny tontolo iainana mbola anatina ala fa fanetana manolona amelan'ny renikazo isaky ny folo metatra.
Ny fambolena azo zany eto a dia mifambolena azo fihinam-bolo zany no matoana eto. Ary misy moa zany ary mbola manana tany malaladalaka zany a dia fanampiana an'ireny azo kininina zay anaovana eucalyptus ireny. Tena ny mampisongadina ny eto amin'ity fokontanin'andro zory ity zany a dia fiarovana an'izy ireny eo amin'ny resaka fiarovana an'le tontolo iainany zany a tsy maintsy mamela renikazo a isaky ny ray ara ary renikazo io zany tena mamelona ny tantelona eto.
Ny kômina aloha dia efa miara-miasa amin'ny mpiompy tantely amin'ny fandripahana ny ala dia izay mpiompy tantely koa manentana ny olona zany tsy andripaka ny ala satria maty le mpiompy telinay.
Io zany a resaka hoe fandoroana ny zavatra tanety zany a eny anatin'ny toerana eny amin'nysehina tsara zany dia tsy na teo hoe fandoroana ny vody tanety misy vody tanety maniry ny zavatra eny a dia tsy azo atao ety aminay a fa dia manapaka dia misoroka ihany zay no azo atao fa fandoroana zany tsisy mihitsy ety aminay na inona na inona atao.